Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tim, the Bible Thumping Wingnut, and we are coming to you live on, now I gotta remember the date. Today is November 23rd, a Sunday evening, around 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. This podcast is originating on the BibleThumpingWingnut.com YouTube channel, and this is a special evening because we have a special non-believer joining us. Aaron Raw is joining us, and he is a rather popular blogger, vlogger, activist, atheist. And if you haven't heard of him, then you haven't been following the debate in any form on the internet. So he's rather well known, and it's an honor to have him joining us this evening, as usual on a Sunday night. Matt Slick from karm.org is here, and in a matter of introduction, I just want to just kind of lay out how this began. I believe Len Pettis contacted Aaron Raw and asked him to come, and he graciously accepted, and the topic tonight will be Christianity in general. And I wanted to kind of prime the conversation. There are other people in the Hangout, but we're going to be silent. Matt Yester is here, and Len Pettis is here, and myself, of course. And we're kind of just going to sit back and listen to Aaron Raw and Matt Slick engage. But to kind of give a little primer for the conversation, Aaron, you just put a video out a couple days ago on your YouTube channel, and I watched it, and you are a very strong atheist. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but from my perspective, you're a very strong atheist, and your latest video was your position on what you know and how you know it. And from a Christian perspective, you're extremely strong atheist because you believe for sure that Jesus Christ never existed, and that Moses never existed, and those are some of your strongest positions. There are others, but just to get us started, could you give us a little bit of review on the presentation that you did on that latest video? It looked like the video started in the middle of a presentation and kind of ended. The video ended before the end of the video. And it is about 35, 40 minutes long. But could you kind of just give us an overview of your latest video? And I'm sure that will give us plenty of content to discuss this evening.
Oh, thank you. One minor correction. While I am convinced that Moses certainly did not exist, there's still some possibility, I suppose, that Jesus might have, but I'm still evaluating that. It would seem that if there is or if there was a Jesus, at best, if he was a composite of multiple different characters, I honestly don't think that if you had a time machine that you would ever be able to find any one person that you would be able to say was the historic Jesus. But if you could find the historic Jesus, then I think at best we would be able to just find him as a faith healer, no different than any of the kind of faith healers we have wandering about now. He was just taking advantage of a different type of situation and demographic in that time. But I think probably there was no historic Jesus. On the topic that they brought me to Arizona, they don't usually tell me what to talk about when they invite me to speak someplace, although I'll have a clue whether it's going to be, you know, is it going to be science, is it going to be secularism, is it going to be skepticism. In this case, they specified that it was to be epistemology. They said they wanted me to talk about what we can and cannot say we know. And I took an opportunity with that because, as I said, I had actually changed my position on this. I was an agnostic atheist when I began all of this a few years ago. And I had since been convinced otherwise, that it is possible to know that, you know, at least in terms of the Bible God, that for certain that does not exist.
Wow. The God of the Bible does not exist.
Right.
How do you know? I've got to ask how you know that.
Well, okay, how would you know that Bugs Bunny or Superman or, you know, Dick Tracy don't exist? How would you know
that? I find it interesting that you instead of defending your position, you bring up cartoons. I mean, what's a cartoon got to do with God's existence or the God of the Bible?
Okay, Indiana Jones from the.
What's that got to do with the God of the Bible?
Well, I'm answering your question with a question to illustrate my position. How would you know whether any fictional character, whether it's a cartoon or it's a, you know, James Bond, for example, any fictional character, how would you know that they're not really real?
Well, you defined it in your logic. You said a fictional character. How do you know a fictional character isn't real? By definition, a fictional character is not real.
Exactly. How do you know that there was no James Bond, for example? Can you know? I suppose I should ask that first. Can you know that there was no James Bond?
You mean, can I know that there's no fictional character named James Bond?
Can you know that spy number 007 does not exist? Can you know that Indiana Jones doesn't exist? Because we don't want to... The reason I chose cartoons is because I want to show something that is obviously fictional in that it is also impossible. For example, Godzilla. This was an example that I brought up in my presentation. How can we know that there is no Godzilla?
I'm not a biologist. I wouldn't be able to tell you the biological functions and reasons why something like Godzilla could not exist.
Okay, but you accept that there are reasons that something like that could not exist. It violates the laws of physics and so forth.
I don't know. I don't know sufficiently the laws of physics and biology to be able to say it could not. I would probably say it's most probable it could not, but I would not assert it could not unless I'm a man of faith.
Okay, well, no, we avoid faith in science. So,
Wait a minute.
It is possible to have science works directly opposite of faith. You either base your beliefs on evidence, or if you don't have evidence, then you base your beliefs on faith. But I don't base beliefs on faith. I base my beliefs on evidence. So with regard to...
One second. Science avoids faith?
Yeah, it works exactly opposite of faith.
Exactly the opposite.
Some explanation to demonstrate why that is. With faith, you can just make up anything that you want and assert it as fact, even though it's not evidently true. But there are rules in science that prohibit you from being able to do that. For example, in faith, you can say that anything is possible, but with science, a scientist cannot say that X is possible until they have some precedent or parallel indicating that possibility, or when they can show that X is indeed a fact, regardless whether they can yet explain it. There are some rules to that. And then you can't give a conclusion either unless it's already indicated by evidence. So you have to be able to show that what you're asserting is actually true. It is dishonest to assert as fact that which is not evidently true. That's why no scientist would do that. But that's what all religions do, because they work exactly opposite.
You actually believe that?
Well, you assert that there's a God that exists, right? And
you're making a lot of assertions that are just not based on faith.
Wait. I'm talking about your assertion that there is a God. And
well, I haven't made an assertion yet.
What? You don't assert that there's a God?
I said I haven't made an assertion tonight now, have I? You have.
So you don't say that there's a God?
I don't say there isn't a God. I say that there is a God.
So you do assert that there is a God?
Yeah, now I do, yeah.
Okay. Uh-huh. So,
but can I tackle some of the things you've been saying here? You're almost verbal carpet bombing here. You said, first of all, you said it's possible to know the God of the Bible doesn't exist. Well, I could take issues with that. You said you avoid faith in science. That's just not true.
That's absolutely true.
Are you absolutely positive?
Yeah, and I already gave you the demonstration of how that is.
So you're absolutely positive that no scientist or whatever uses any faith in any way, shape, or form. So Let me finish.
We have dishonest scientists, too. We have scientists who use unethical practices. But in the practice of science, ideally, you would not have people using bad science. They wouldn't be making dishonest assertions. So if you're going to do science properly, then you have to make your conclusions evidently true. You can't state as fact that which is not evidently true, because it is dishonest. As I said, that is what all religions do, but scientists cannot do that because it would impugn their own credibility.
Can I back up? Because every time I try to make a point, you jump in and stop me from making a point.
Okay.
So, I'm trying to...
Your point was that science uses faith
I've had this argument with absolutely every single apologist I've ever met. They've always been wrong. I'm sorry if I can just predict that that's what's going to happen. And it's never going to be true. It doesn't matter how many times apologists say that scientists have faith in science. No, that's not true. That is a misrepresentation.
But I haven't said anything yet about it, have I?
Okay.
So you have faith that the laws of logic will work and always work?
Wrong. You're misdefining faith.
Wait a minute.
If you look at the definition of faith.
Hold on a second. If you're the one who's not a man of faith, but I am, and you're going to tell me how to define faith, and maybe that's, you know, a misappropriation of our respective categories. I understand what science is, and science is based on a measure of faith. You have to presuppose the validity of the laws of logic. You have to presuppose the uniformity of nature. Yes, you do. You cannot use the scientific method to validate either one. And don't tell me you can. You beg the question. You beg the question when you assume the uniformity of nature. You assume its uniformity, and then you base a scientific method on the uniformity. But you cannot test it via the scientific method and establish its truth. You make these faith assertions all the time. That's my point.
Faith assertions. I don't ever make faith because, you know, I'm not just an atheist.
Wait a minute. You don't ever. You're so self-refuting. You don't ever make faith assertions?
That's right. Because I'm not just...
That's right there is a faith assertion.
I'm not just an atheist. I'm also an epistemist. Now, an epistemist is one who rejects faith as being the most dishonest position it is possible to have. And it doesn't matter what source you look at to look it up. If you compare different definitions from scriptural references, from hymns, from sermons of theologians, past and present, so forth, you're going to get a consensus definition. There is a second definition that exists only in a dictionary, which is a secure confidence in a person, place, or thing, and the value or the trustworthiness of that thing. But that definition appears only in the dictionary. It doesn't appear in the religious references. In the religious references, faith is a belief that you assume, it's a secure conviction that is assumed without reason and defended against all reason. I don't have that.
That's not what faith is.
Yeah, I know. And faith also requires apologetics. Science doesn't. Apologetics is making up...
Yes, you are. You're doing apologetics right now.
Right. Apologetics is a practice devised...
Aaron, you are walking contradiction.
I'm sorry if you don't understand this, but no, that's of course not the case.
Yes, I do understand. You're making lots of logic mistakes. Okay. And you talk so fast, you don't want them disclosed. You're making all these statements. Faith is the most dishonest.
None of which are based on faith. And regardless how fast or slow I say this, science does not rely on faith.
Yes, it does. You Absolutely. Have faith that the universe is always going to be the same way. Show me how you've tested that the universe will always behave in the same way.
I already gave you demonstrations of how science works opposite of faith.
Hold on a sec. Aaron, show me how you've tested the universe is always going to act the same way so that you can trust the scientific method all the time.
Okay. Then I probably should have started this conversation with a different tact just to make sure where we are.
A logical one, please.
Yeah, well, you know, of course, I wouldn't necessarily have to in this kind of conversation, but I mentioned in my talk that when dealing with apologists, that the position is such that they have to argue somehow that reality isn't really real.
What?
God isn't real.
What reality is real?
So it somehow it always has to turn out to be that reality somehow isn't really real. You can't know that the laws...
I'm disagreeing with you. Reality is real.
Reality is real by definition, correct?
Yes, because that's what definition at least is by reality. Reality is what it is. First law of logic.
Good. Thank you for that. Because
You should ask me what I believe instead of it.
No, I'm
you've got faith in what I believe? You haven't tested it yet.
I have. I watched a debate that you had with Matt Dillahunty, and you did exactly what I was talking about, where you're arguing that reality somehow isn't real. I know you don't understand what my explanation is, and it's probably not any.
Wait a minute. How do you know I don't understand?
Because of the way you're responding. You're expressing how you don't understand.
Well, then I can say the same thing. You're not very logical because of the way you're responding. You don't understand really what the issues are of logic and your assertions that are unfounded. I can make the same assertions.
I don't have any unfounded assertions.
Unless you have faith it's so.
I don't have any unfounded assertions. Again, you can either
really?
Base your position on faith or you can base your...
You beg the question left and right.
I didn't beg a question. That's the fact. You either base your position on evidence or you base it on faith. I base mine on evidence.
Really? What's the evidence that the laws of logic are true?
Okay, again, you're trying to change it away because you've made an indefensible statement and you're now trying to pin it on me.
Wait. You're the one who said it, responding to you. I'm trying to show you that your science is based, in a small measure, on faith. You have faith that the laws of logic are consistent. You have faith in your
theory to prove that science is in no way based on faith at all. And I have the demonstrations that can't prove that.
That's just not true. That's just not true.
Yes,
don't you understand that? Don't you understand that?
I understand that science doesn't base on faith. Yes, I understand that.
Okay, prove to me the laws of logic are true without using the logic and then begging the question. Go ahead. Why change the subject based on that. You got to have it.
Why change the subject from what it is? You made a statement.
Aaron, dude, respond to what you're saying. R-N. I'm trying to show you. But you don't want to give in.
Of course I don't want to give in. I can't confess to things that are wrong. So
it's logically true what I'm saying.
No,
it is
what you're saying.
Then answer the question.
Answer what question? I was answering the question.
You have faith the laws of logic are universally true, but you can't test them. You have faith that they are. You assume their validity.
The scientific method is based in part
on the laws of logic. So tell me how you've used the scientific method to determine the validity of the laws of logic without begging the question.
I don't have to beg a question. Faith is a belief that is not based on evidence, that is held independent of evidence. It's an unreasonable conviction that is also defended against all reason, which is why apologetics exist.
So you're an epistemist, and you can't answer this basic question on knowledge dealing with...
I am answering the basic question.
You're not. You're self-destructing.
I'm not basing any of my perspective on faith. I have evidence. Now,
are you absolutely sure?
Yes, I'm absolutely sure. I have evidence.
Every statement you make is always based on evidence.
Yeah.
Then why did you make assumptions about what I believe and you got it wrong?
Because I already watched you in the debate with Matt Delahunty.
So you had faith that I would say a certain thing.
Yeah, I did watch you demonstrate that very thing.
Wow.
Yeah, and I've seen
I didn't say what you said.
So I know what your position is, and I got
What's
it
What's my position?
What?
What's my position?
You're going to try to play a word game wherein, and I know you don't understand this at first, but let me get to it.
Wait a second. Don't assault me, please. Okay, please tell you, I know you don't understand. Come on, RN. I know you don't understand what real epistemology is. I'm sorry, but I just know you don't understand
it. But I'm talking to a presuppositionalist. And that means
you don't know what I am?
No.
I assume some forms of presuppositionalism and rationalism and evidentialism.
Okay, so thank you. If we're going to talk about evidentialism...
Your faithful judgment in me was wrong.
I don't have a faithful judgment.
Yes, you do. You had to faith in what I said, and you were wrong.
Believe me, I don't have faith in what you say. I can say that for certain.
Equivocation.
I did watch a little bit of stuff because I needed to find out who you are when I was invited on this. So I did watch a couple of things that you did, and yeah, you were doing exactly what I expected you to do. So
you're gonna be logical.
That never happens. We're talking about a presupposition.
I never was logical.
Right, and none of the presentations that I see so far. And especially when you do what I predict. If you've ever watched any of my videos full the way through, you'll probably see that I talk about how creationists and other form of apologists always refer to the lies of equivocation and projection, wherein they want to argue that science is based on faith. Somehow they have to create the illusion of an equal playing field. And they can only do this by asserting that somehow science is religious and that religion is somehow scientific. And so the first step of that is to try to assert or push faith onto those who will not share that label or that practice. And I try to give demonstrations of how we don't. Now, we have evidence that the laws of physics have been constant so far as we can detect up to this point. That's evidence. That's not faith. So you ask me, how do I know? I have the evidence. That's how I know. And so when you make an assertion, you can do this on faith without any evidence, but in science, you have to have evidence first. You can say that something is probably true only if you have evidence indicating that probability. But you can't state anything as fact if it's not evidently true, and in faith, you can. And in faith, you don't have to admit when you're wrong either. You can just go on.
So the problem that you've got is your epistemology is a little bit off.
I don't think so. You started up the statement with a false statement, and I corrected it, and I can continue to do so. I can continue to give
how
science doesn't rely on faith and how science actually works to refute faith. One of the ways is by objective analysis and peer review. So that whatever, in a faith-based situation, you would have heresy. You would have people that are supposed to conform to a given belief based on authoritarianism. But with science, you have the opposite. As I said, you have to submit your math, your conclusion.
You don't understand Christianity.
What?
You don't understand what you're criticizing. Christianity is not based
on
authoritarianism.
I wasn't criticizing anything. You don't understand that I'm not criticizing anything. I was talking about, well, I'm criticizing faith in general, but it's not Christianity in specific. What I'm talking about also applies to Islam and Hinduism and a number of other religions. If it's faith, then that's the problem. But I'm talking
faith
about how
is a problem?
Science works
okay,
opposite.
Okay, I'm going to prove to you have faith. I'm going to prove it to you.
Okay, I'd like to find out why is it that it is necessary for you to prove that I have faith? Is it because you realize what a detriment faith is?
No.
Do you on some level agree with me about how dishonest faith is? Is it possible to
Wait,
make
faith is dishonest?
Honest than it is?
Faith is dishonest. Just so you know, I want to be a marine biologist. I have a high view of science.
Okay.
I really do. I love science, okay?
Okay.
I don't watch sports. I watch documentaries. I watch the Nature Channel. I love that kind of stuff, okay?
Okay?
And when people come up to me and say they've had a spiritual experience, maybe they've seen something, what I do is I test alternative options for explanation. When none of those are satisfactory, then I'll consider the spiritual aspect of things. I understand what science is, okay? Mm-hmm. It's a method of observation. You develop a hypothesis. Then what you do is you develop a methodology to test your hypothesis. And your hypothesis is either verified, disproven, or it's modified. Eventually, hopefully what happens if you don't discard the hypothesis through repetition, you then develop a theory. A theory is generally accepted to be a suitable explanation until something else comes along that may alter it. That's the scientific method.
The theory has a little higher accolade than that. It's essentially correct, but it also refutes what you said in the opening statement about science working as a matter of faith, which clearly it does not, because everything has to be tested. You don't just believe it. And with
everything
faith,
has to be tested?
With faith, there's no way. Faith is a matter of preservation of belief, so there's nothing you would accept to ever prove you wrong. In fact, that's why apologetics exists.
How do you test the scientific method?
What?
How do you test a scientific method to make sure that it's the right way to go things?
How
do you do it?
Through
assume it.
Peer review and objective analysis, yes.
No. That's begging the question.
Uh-huh.
You don't know the logic. You're begging the question. How do you know the scientific method is the right one? Because we have peer reviews who say it's the right one. You have people in the scientific community who say this is the right way to do things. How do they know it's the right thing? Because we agree that it's the right way to do things.
No. It has nothing to do with what you agree on. It's with you test it.
Sure.
Right. So you submit it to testing. How do you test the testing?
But nevertheless.
Is that what you're asking me?
Nevertheless. No, you're begging the question. You assume the validity of science, but you can't use science. You can't
by the application of science. That's how you test it. It's an ongoing test. It's a self-correcting process.
You can't use science to validate science, can you?
Yes, you can.
That's called begging the question.
That's not called, no, it's a fallacy again. It's not called begging
the question. Yes, it is. It's called begging the question.
No, because the scientific method is self-correcting. You can use it to test itself. You can run your own tests, however you like. And if somebody else comes up and says, hey, maybe there's something other than science that would work better than science.
Fallacy of inflation on your part.
If somebody were to come up with that, then they could subject that and test that. But, it doesn't happen because science actually can be used to test itself.
Okay. Now, this faith stuff is really interesting. I'm going to prove to you have faith.
Okay. I don't. And I object to faith as being the most...
I'm going to prove it.
Okay. You're going to play a word game by which you think you can, but no.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Prove to me you're the same person you were a week ago. And prove to yourself that you're the same person, the exact same person, and not just created 5 minutes ago with all these memories and stuff. Prove to me the continuity, or prove to yourself the continuity of your own existence from a week ago to now.
So what you're saying is that your argument is that everything could be an illusion and I could have been created a week ago, right? That's what you're telling me now?
I didn't say that.
I
didn't say that. I asked you to demonstrate the continuity.
You
can't prove it, can you? You assume you're the same person you were.
You ask a question from a guy who won't answer the question.
You don't get it. I'm surprised you're using these arguments.
I'm not using an argument. I'm inquiring.
I know, not a very good one.
I am trying to ask you what your argument is, and you keep interrupting me to get a clarification. And
well, I can show you.
Laughing as if you've got an upper hand is not helping you. This is too easy to see through. Now, are you asking me to prove that I existed a week ago and against the alternate possibility, as you presented, that I might have been created with false memories just a week ago? Is that really what you're asking me?
I asked you to prove to yourself that you're the same person you were a week ago.
Okay. And the option is, the alternate possibility that you want me to consider is that, in a sense, reality is not real, that everything is an illusion, that I was created in a series of illusions a week ago. Is that not what you're telling me?
No. It says you can't prove
it. What's the option then? If I didn't exist a week ago, what's the alternate option that I need to consider?
I asked you to prove to yourself that you're the same person you were a week ago. I didn't ask you to prove it to me. I mean, I did. I corrected it to you.
Regardless who I'm proving it to. Okay, we have the situation where I have evidence that I am the same guy I was a week ago. What's the alternate hypothesis that I need to consider?
All right, let me finish my statement. Since you can't prove to yourself...
I'll let you finish your statement again, or I'll let you create a new statement.
Hold on. Why is an alternative necessary, Aaron?
Hold on. Let me finish this guy.
Okay, well, no, you can't finish me.
Yes,
so,
I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. I'm going to drill it. You keep interrupting.
Okay, I will let you finish again.
You can't prove to me or anybody else, including yourself, that you're the same person that you were a week ago. Therefore, you take it on faith. Bingo.
No, I can prove it. Bingo. I have to have an alternate possibility to consider. You have to present what it is.
No, you tell me what the alternative is.
What is it?
There I don't know. One. Don't do the Dilhanti fallacy and say there's another option and don't say it.
I have identification that shows my age. I can show you any number of documents that show that I
How
own these houses.
How does yeah, that prove for you?
What kind of documentation do I need to show?
Documentation? Yeah, I didn't ask you. I asked you. You have to prove it to me and prove it to yourself. So you look at your ID, your birth certificate. Does that prove that you're the same person you were back then?
So, well, of course it does, unless there's some other possibility.
Okay.
Hey, you want
to consider. Let me ask a question for you guys, maybe, because I watched all of Aaron's last video, and in your last video, Aaron, you stated that you didn't know whether or not what you're experiencing is real because you could be part of a dream, you could be...
No, I said exactly the opposite of that,
Didn't you say that you could be in a simulated?
No, I said that whole thing is philosophical nonsense. For the
you
reason,
you did say it was nonsense, but before you said it was nonsense, you said it doesn't matter if I am.
Why it's nonsense?
You said it doesn't matter if you are, because what you're experiencing is what you're experiencing.
Even if we lend to the question the possibility. It wouldn't matter. Even if we pretend that it's really possible that we're in the Matrix or that we're a brain in the vat or so on, even if we lend that possibility, which I don't,
okay.
But if we were to lend to that, then it wouldn't make any difference because the rules of that reality still apply to us. So it negates itself. That's why the argument is nonsense.
Okay. Well, I just wanted you to clarify that because you just kind of hit it real quick in your video, and I want to see if that was...
So in this thing about whether I need to prove myself, prove that I exist, there has to be some other option that I do not exist. And what this guy said a few minutes ago, and which I can't seem to get him to repeat, is that he wanted me to admit that I could have been magically created with false memories less than a week ago. You did actually say with false memories. This is a recorded conversation.
No, did I say magically created?
Well, yeah. You didn't say the word magical, but you're still talking
about... No, atheists bring up magic first. They always do.
Okay. What do you want to call it?
I don't call it anything. I'm just asking you to demonstrate that you have continuity from a week ago to now. You can't do that. You don't relearn everything.
Let
me show you.
Yes, I can. Look, I can't. The reason I've already given.
Then you take it on faith.
I don't take it on faith. I have evidence, and the evidence that I have in this case, as I said,
I didn't ask for evidence. I asked for proof.
And that what is proof? Proof is an overwhelming preponderance of evidence.
So
I'm
what's
sorry
the evidence?
To throw your definitions wrong.
What's the evidence?
What?
What's the evidence? One at a time, and let me show you how it doesn't work. What's your evidence? Your
once
birth
again,
certificate?
Once again, why would a birth certificate not be sufficient? Why would any other means of documentation not be sufficient?
A piece of paper with writing on it proves you're the same person you were a week ago?
Yeah, pretty much. If you want to try to get away from the police on some crime that you committed a month ago, you really think that you can prove that you're somehow not identified as magic but some other means not the same person you were a month ago even though that was you? What is the alternate possibility here that I need to consider? You're presenting another hypothesis wherein I might not be the same guy I was a week ago. So what separate contingency is that? You said that I could have been created.
What I'm doing.
You said that I could have been created with false memories.
I said, how do you know you weren't?
Right. Because, one, science has to have a precedent or a parallel to express that some possibility actually exists, or they have to be able to show that X is indeed a fact. We don't have that. We have something that is not possible, which is where you're talking about that my whole past life is an illusion, and that somehow, as I said earlier, reality isn't real. That is, in fact,
I didn't say that's what I was saying. That's not what I was saying.
If I have false memories,
I didn't say that.
Is not you did say that.
Well, I didn't say you have false memories.
If I have false memories, as you said earlier,
I didn't say you have false memories.
Okay, record a conversation. We'll just go back.
I said, look, I do this a lot. How do you know that you're the same person? How do you know you were not created with these false memories? I didn't say you had false memories. I said, how do you know you weren't created that way? You can't prove. Now, let me finish.
It's an easy question. Because it's not possible for me to have been created with false memories.
All right, you have faith in that, or you prove it is true?
We have evidence for that. I don't have faith in anything.
You don't have faith in anything.
The most dishonest position it is possible.
So you have faith that you're always right?
I don't need faith, and I don't have faith. Faith would be a belief that is not based on evidence. Believe me, I have evidence of being right.
Okay. Well, we're arguing in circles. You're arguing absurdity. Why don't we go to something else? Why don't you pick something?
Absurdity.
No, you are arguing absurdity.
You opened up the statement by saying the same thing all the apologists say, that science has faith. And then you want me to believe that reality isn't real. And I could
science
have
can't have faith. Science is a methodology.
Right. Science is a methodology because it doesn't have faith.
I didn't say science has faith.
Yes, you did. You said scientists have faith. You said science has
faith.
Wait
a minute. Wait a minute. Science or scientists?
You said both. You said science was an expression of faith.
Science is based, the methodology is based on assumptions, I said. Who makes assumptions?
It doesn't base it on assumptions. There are some rules applied, and we do follow those. And as I said, one of those rules is that you can't express something as being possible that hasn't been indicated to be possible. You have to have something that indicates that possibility. So when you want to talk about how I might have false memories and have been artificially created a week ago, you have to give that kind of possibility, or it's not possible. So therein, I can show whatever documentation would be otherwise necessary, and I can prove that I'm the same person I was a week ago. If you have to express the possibility that I'm not.
You don't understand the philosophy of the argument. Otherwise, you wouldn't be saying what you're
okay.
saying.
And I know that you have to smile confidently and wave your hand as, you don't understand, you silly man. But I do, and I've watched your discussions, and it's sad. And I'm not going to laugh, and I'm not going to wave my hands, and I'm not going to pretend the arrogance that you have to for your show. But that is the fact of it. Your position is so weak that, as I predicted and as I said on stage, you have to first attack reality itself. How do you know that the laws of physics won't change 5 seconds from now? How do you know that you were the same
because
person?
God is a necessary precondition for the intelligibility and consistency of the universe. You don't know. So have you ever read the problem of induction? You ever studied the problem of induction?
What did you just say about God?
God is the necessary preconditions for all of this intelligibility. I can say
You did just make an assertion about God, which has no evidence behind it. Assertions about God have no evidence behind it. How do I know? I've been doing this for 20 years. This
okay,
is how
what
I know.
Kind of evidence would you look for God? What kind of evidence might you think?
Well, a certain consistency that we don't have. I would expect virtually everything in reality to be very different if there was a God. For one thing, we wouldn't require faith to believe in a God. God wouldn't require faith to begin with. There would be some consistency behind the religion. You wouldn't be judged on whether or not you believe, because if you're going to be judging people on whether they believe, then you're
all over the place.
A salesman trying to sell nothing for something at a high price.
Okay. What kind of evidence would you expect from a transcendent being?
It depends. What's it trying to transcend? I mean, if we were to...
Are you serious? Are you serious?
Absolutely, yes. What is it trying
What's
to
it transcend? What's it trying to transcend? Do you have any idea what the Christian God is?
Yes, certainly.
Okay, define for me what the Christian God is.
The Christian God is a magical, anthropomorphic immortal that, following the definition of all deities, has human characteristics, miraculous powers, and the ability to survive the death of its own body. It's an adaptation of the Jewish God, which is an adaptation on earlier polytheist mythos, but the Christian adaptation of that is that you have to believe that this particular personification of your deity is somehow a savior, so that you can be saved from the damnation that the deity would impose upon you if you didn't believe in it.
Boy, do you not understand biblical theology.
I know that you're going to pretend that I don't, but I nailed it.
I don't have to pretend anything. I have a Master's of Divinity from Westminster Theological Seminary. I'm qualified to tell you theologically what the Christian faith is, what the Christian God is, and I'm going to just tell you, you don't know what you're talking about here.
Okay, so which part of it wrong?
Basically all of it. First, okay, starting with the word magical.
Magical,
immortal. Let me tell you who God is.
Magical certainly works because it has the same definition as does miracle, right?
Wow.
It's both the evocation of supernatural powers or entities to control or forecast natural events, and it secondarily is also defined as being inexplicable by science because it defies the laws of physics. Am I on the right track here? Is that what a miracle
is?
No,
you're not on the right track at all.
Okay, then show me why all of the consensus of every definitional source is wrong and you are right. How is a miracle not related to magic?
How is a miracle not related to magic? Now notice everybody what this guy's doing, talking at 80 miles an hour, changing the topic as he goes along, and ends with an accusatory type question.
Wrong in a statement where every statement...
I'm going to define for you what the Christian concept of God is.
Okay, every piece of that collective comment that I made is defensive. You're going to tell me that it was all wrong, but you can't show me that any of it is wrong. Okay?
Wow.
You want to argue magic? Look up what magic is. Look up what miracle is. They're the same damn thing. So that part's right. So now let's talk about human characteristics. Intelligence.
Okay, can we get back on you? I mean, seriously. I mean, I could say some real interesting things about your...
Can you show me anything about my description?
Let me finish for a stinking second.
Just one thing. Since you said the entire statement that I made was wrong about the Christian God, and in fact, every individual piece of everything that I said was completely right, can you show me anything that I said that was actually wrong with regard to the Christian God?
Well, this is what you do, Aaron. Make a single statement, not a multifaceted statement at 80 miles an hour for 3 minutes, and then say, now what part of that's wrong? I don't type 800 words a minute. Now, I will tell you, I'm going to put it in text, Christian definition of God.
Mm-hmm.
There it is. Okay? The Christian definition of God. The only supreme, eternally self-aware being who had no beginning, nor will he cease to exist, who is non-contingent, transcendent, we've got to define what transcendence is now, immutable, and of whom no greater being exists. His attributes include holiness, omniscience, omnisapience, that's all wisdom, omnipotence, omnipresence, logic, righteousness, mercy, grace, etc. He's revealed to us in the person of Jesus Christ. That's the Christian position. I'm not arguing anything else.
Right. And
now, transcendence means that God is non-dependent upon the universe in space and time, and he's not restricted by space and time.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he means. He transcends the universe. So, if God is transcendent, how do you as a scientist develop a test for a transcendent being that automatically can't be found in a scientific method?
Once again, if you and I were describing a movie or a book or a person or an animal or anything else, we might give different definitions or different descriptions, rather, different descriptions of the same thing. And my description of the Christian God, though it's not phrased the way you would word it, is still correct.
It's not an issue of phraseology. Dare I say I'm quite qualified to be able to defend the Christian faith, as I've been doing it since 1980. I got a Master's of Divinity. You want me to show you the picture of my MDiv up here? I got a website that gets 2 million page views a month. I've been doing radio for 9 years. I write books. I know what Christian theology is. You got it wrong.
Okay.
I just say, all you got to do is say, look, yeah, you know, I could work on my definition. Okay, fine.
I was correct. There's not a single aspect of what I said that you could show is wrong.
So how do you develop a test for a transcendent being?
That depends. What's it trying to transcend?
It doesn't try and transcend anything. It's so ridiculous. I could just see God outside the universe. Okay. I'm trying to transcend.
What transcendent means and the different applications of it?
He's transcendent by his nature. He doesn't have to try to do anything if he's transcendent by nature.
Transcending what?
I just told you. The universe, space and time. He's not dependent upon it.
Okay. So God doesn't have to act within his own nature.
His nature is transcendence.
Okay, so he can transcend his own nature.
Are you serious?
Well, you did just tell me that his nature is transcendence. That would require that he can transcend his own nature, doesn't it?
Wow. Okay.
Can he not transcend his nature? He's not transcendence.
That's a logical self-contradictory statement you're saying.
What does transcendence mean? What is he transcending?
I defined it for you three times already.
You said transcendence is transcendence. His nature is transcendence. That's not defined.
I said he does not depend upon the universe for his existence. He's not restricted by space and time. Hence his transcendence.
Okay.
That's what it is. Then you say, can he transcend himself?
Well, you said his nature was transcendence. It was a contradictory statement. I only showed you that it was a contradictory statement. So you make a statement about God, saying that he's omniscient and omnipotent and all of these things. He's bigger than big and stronger than strong, and he's grander in every dimension one can exaggerate. But you're making these statements without any evidence to back it up. There's no indication that this thing is even real. So what we have is two different perspectives looking both at the same thing.
I have no evidence, huh?
I'm looking at...
There is no evidence for God's existence?
Exactly.
Have you tested all potential evidences?
Has anyone presented an evidence that could bear any testing? Do you have any?
I asked you. I already have a way to prove God exists, but I asked you, according to your own criteria, for the evidence of a transcendent being. You don't even know.
If you have a way of proving that God exists, why have you always failed to do so? Why is there still a
persuasion?
Why is there still a faith-based belief required in every religion in the world if you've proven that God exists?
I don't care about every religion in the world. I care about Christianity.
Do you understand that, relativity, Einstein's relativity, you remember how that was proven? Do you remember?
No, I don't remember how it was proven.
Well, it happened before you were born, so it's all right. But I mean,
how do you think I am?
In the study, I don't think you were around in 1931. But anyway, I understand that probably shouldn't said remember, but maybe in remembering in your studies, there was a way to prove relativity
My IQ and training are not high enough for me able to look at the proof and understand it. But I have faith that the proof is valid. Do you have faith that the proof is valid also, or have you tested it?
Because faith would be a belief that is not based on evidence. My belief is based on evidence. It is therefore not faith. But there was a way to prove...
So you have faith the evidence is correct.
I said there was a way to prove relativity. Now, if you had proven the existence of God, there wouldn't be faith required in that belief in every religion in the world.
Hey, guys, I want to get each of you to define faith.
I did. Favorite definition of that would be that it is an unreasonable conviction that is assumed without reason and defended against all reason. But the one that you're going to find in most sources, the consensus is that it is a stoic conviction that is assumed without evidence and is independent of evidence and defended against all evidence, which is what apologetics exists for. It exists to defend faith against evidence.
Okay.
My definition.
Matt, give us your definition.
Faith is a profound trust based on evidence and reason. Jesus appeared in John 20, 25-28 to Stephen. He said, look, here's my hand, put your finger into my hand. It's after the resurrection, here's my side, put your hand in my side, now believe. You know, when people tell me that, when people tell me that faith is just something we have as Christians, and there's no reason or evidence for it, they're convincing me, they're telling me they don't know what they're talking about, and you don't.
Okay, so you have a hearsay document, you have a story. And
you keep ignoring the points I'm making, and you jump to something else. It's a sign of intellectual weakness on your part to do this repeatedly. I show you something that you have a mistake in, and then what you do is you ignore it and go to something else.
You didn't show me any.
Yes, I did. I showed you the biblical definition of faith that is exemplified by Christ himself. You ignored it and went to something else.
No, you showed me the definition that I told you earlier exists only in the dictionary and does not exist in the sermons, in the scriptures of any religion.
I just showed you and gave you the references in John 20, 25 through 28. I told you what happened. Jesus says, here's the evidence, now believe.
Right, so you're taking a hearsay account from a story that you believe.
That's a different issue. That's a different issue than the definition of what faith is biblically.
You're not looking at the same claim that would be made in the Bhagavad Gita, for example, when Lord Krishna.
We're not arguing the Bhagavad Gita.
Why not?
I'm arguing the Quran.
Why would you not believe when?
Because I'm a Christian.
When Krishna manifests his true God form before King Arjuna,
you believe that?
How much greater a definition? Well, no, I don't have faith like you do.
I don't believe that.
The account from an old storybook like you do. When Krishna,
storybook? Okay.
Because when Krishna reveals his multi-armed form and all of this, his supreme uber-galactic cosmos to his cosmic form to King Arjuna, why would that not convince you? For the same reason that listening to the story from the fables that you just read to me don't convince me either, because the fable is not evidence.
RN, you're making a mistake. We went through the definition of faith. I showed you biblically what that definition is, and then you just go to something else. You continue to ignore the points. You are not very logical at all. I'm dead serious. You're one of the most illogical, irrational individuals I've met.
I went to the definition of faith. You gave me the definition that only exists in the dictionary and is not supported in Scripture.
I gave it to you out of Scripture.
No, you referred to me to a confidence in the trustworthiness of a person, place, or thing.
I said, according to the Scriptures, Jesus said in John 20, 25 through 28, when Thomas was doubting, Jesus appeared and said, put your hand into my side, hand into my side, your finger into my hand, see, touch me, now believe. I'm showing you,
right. What did he say right immediately after that? You have seen and you have believed, but blessed are those who believe and have not seen.
Yeah.
That's what faith is. It's believing what you don't see.
Oh, so in other words, you take
faith,
I get it. So you take part of what Jesus says, not the other part. So you pick and choose arbitrarily.
No, take the whole statement together.
Did Jesus really say that?
If it says the whole, no, there was no Jesus. But if it's just
what? There was no Jesus? How do you know that? How have you tested scientifically there was no Jesus?
Because
the
evidence so far indicates that if there was a historic Jesus, then it was apparently a compilation of at least 3 to 5 different individuals.
Really? Where'd you get that from? Where's the scientific evidence for that?
I actually can post it from a number of people that I know, like Richard Carrier and Robert Price. They've got some really good arguments on this. I've uploaded some of their videos.
I've debated Robert Price informally, and I found him to be sincere and misguided in some of his arguments, and uninformed.
I mean, you say a whole bunch of things that are just flat out wrong. Like
you said Jesus doesn't exist. How do you know?
Lies on faith. That was a completely wrong statement.
Proof? No, it's not, because it's a biblical statement that I showed you from the Christian perspective, which is what I'm arguing. And then you say I'm not right about the issue of the Scriptures. Then you quote Jesus, who you say didn't even exist, to argue against a position.
I also quoted Krishna, who doesn't exist, because they're characters in storybooks.
Now, how do you know Jesus never existed? Have you tested it scientifically?
If you remember at the beginning of this, I said that I don't yet know if Jesus existed, but that if he did, and it's not likely that he did, because the evidence that I have seen indicates that he was made up as an astral sort of a character and then was given a history posthumously, or after the fact, as it were. Moses, on the other hand, definitely didn't exist, no question there. I said,
how do you know Moses didn't exist? Where's your scientific evidence that he didn't exist?
Well, because there's no scientific evidence that he did exist, but there's an overwhelming preponderance of evidence to other things that existed.
Do you believe Alexander the Great existed?
There are a number of historical characters.
Do you believe Alexander the Great existed?
I haven't investigated Alexander the Great, but I have investigated Hypatia, and I was upset to find that there's insufficient data for her to verify that she actually existed, which is a sad thing. I would really like to believe that there was a Hypatia. But everything that I've been able to find for her basically tracks down to one document, and it's not a historic document. It's something that could easily be just a story. If that's all I've got, then that's not enough.
Are historical figures the proper subject of scientific methodology in order to validate their existence?
History operates a little bit different than mainstream science, but you still have evidence, you still have concordance with different events in history.
What's the evidence for the existence of Alexander the Great?
Again, I haven't studied Alexander the Great. Would you like to ask me about Hypatia?
What's the evidence for Hypatia's existence?
The evidence for Hypatia's existence is, as I said, a single document that has been many times quoted, and it had been quoted by historians, but when you trace down what the historians are actually referencing, it comes down to one document that is not a historical document in itself. Okay. It's a document that might have been talking about a real person.
Do you believe he existed?
Do I believe who existed?
Hypatia.
Hypatia's a woman.
Okay. Do you believe she existed?
I don't know, because I don't have any evidence to be conclusive.
What would be the evidence to be conclusive?
I would need something to corroborate that one document.
Like
or
what?
A historical record, perhaps.
Like what?
Well, as I said, the document that everybody traces is not in itself a historical record. It's a story. And the story might or might not have been fictitious.
So you bring up...
What?
So you bring up a possible fictitious character that you can't validate in order to substantiate your argument about Jesus not being existing.
I'm saying that Jesus is not the only person in history for which we don't know if he actually existed or not. There are others.
No, you said he didn't, or you said Moses did not exist.
Right, Moses definitely didn't. Jesus probably didn't.
And how do you know Moses did not exist?
Well, there's every aspect of Moses was stolen from another culture.
How do you know that?
Well, because I read. Okay, Moses' childhood, for example, was taken from Sargon. Sargon is somebody we can verify. He doesn't just exist in the Bible. He also exists in the Sumerian king list and other documents, too. And the story for Sargon way predates the times given for Moses. We don't even know what the times are for Moses, just sometime in the 2nd century B.C., preferably the latter half of the 2nd century B.C., but nobody knows because nothing matches up for his history. There's no evidence that any 2 million Jews were ever in a country that was occupied by only 3.5 million Egyptians at the time. There's no evidence for this. Everything about the story doesn't make any sense. And it was obviously stolen from other cultures. There's no reason to go from Canaan. You don't have to cross the Red Sea. That part of the story is fictitious. It's only 130 miles away. Do you realize that if they were to do a single file line, walking 2 miles a day, 20 miles a day, it would take only a week to get there. But with God's help, you could be lost in the desert for 40 years. If you started as a single file line, that line of 2 million Hebrews would stretch 2,000 kilometers, way more than the 130 miles they need to go, and nobody would have to cross the Red Sea to get there. But if they did, then why would you have to have Moses' birth story stolen from Sargon, and then his parting of the Red Sea stolen from Seneferu and his maid?
How do you know they were stolen? Were you back there? Did you see it happen? Or you have faith that it was?
Because
you're a man of great faith.
No faith whatsoever.
You're a man of great faith.
No faith whatsoever. But think about this.
You have great faith in your ability to think.
I have no faith whatsoever, and it doesn't matter how many times you make a false accusation, it will still be false. So when you have in the same culture, this is Egypt we're talking about, we had Moses parting the Red Sea to get out all these Hebrews, but in the same area, 1,000 years earlier, we already had the same story attributed to another guy.
How do you know that?
What?
How do you know that?
Because it's in the Westcar Papyrus.
So that's a scientific document? Has it been peer-reviewed?
It's not a scientific document, but it dates to prior to any time given for Moses.
I thought science was how you had to go. That wasn't peer-reviewed.
Yeah, it was, because they have to do the
dating. Who peer-reviewed the ancient document back then?
They when they find the tablets, they can date the tablets, and they can do a concordance with the other histories and documents of the time. Yeah, the scientific method.
How do you know that those are accurately recorded documents? You have faith that they are?
No, because faith was
not believed. So they're not. You're just
evidence. Not based on.
So you have a document. You just assume it's written back then and accurately represented.
I have evidence to imply this because this is also peer reviewed, which means we don't just take one person's word for it. It ends up being tested and correlated, and other people are open to peer review forever. That's not like there's ever a time that it's closed. That's why there's a Moses Jesus mythicist issue right now, is because it's constantly under peer review, and we're finding, you know what? It's these things aren't checking out. So everything that's attributed to Moses, and I mean everything, was taken from somebody else. Like, look at how he gets the Ten Commandments, for example, which Christians don't even know what the Ten Commandments are. This is so disturbing. And then Moses actually is adapting this story from another story from at least 500 years earlier, if you take the date that he's supposed to be with Ramses, which, of course, that doesn't match up. But if Moses is taking the Ten Commandments from God, then why is it an adaptation of a story that had already taken place and which can be historically verified to have happened with Hammurabi around 1750 BC?
Have you done the scientific tests on all that stuff that you're talking about? Believe what the people say on faith?
I don't believe anything on faith, and it doesn't matter how many times you say that. It's still going to be wrong. You can say it forever. You're always going to be wrong.
You have faith in their integrity, don't you?
No, I don't have faith in anything. That would be a belief that is not based on evidence, and as I am demonstrating,
So you have absolutely...
Not only have no evidence, but you have to push your own faults onto opponents who will not share those flaws.
Let me chime in here.
Yes, it is. I don't know how else I can help you.
Let me slow down.
You are the most illogical atheist I've ever encountered.
Wait.
You beg the question, make so many logical mistakes. I'm serious, RN, and all the ones I've encountered, I have not met anybody who's made as many goofs and mistakes and self-reputations as you have.
Amazing. Guys, let me chime in. I want to ask a question. Okay.
Jeez.
RN, wait. Okay. Let's all calm down. This is a great conversation. Very spicy.
No, it isn't. That's a sad thing. And I knew that it was going to be like.
RN, let me ask you a question. Okay. On everything that you've cited, okay, because you haven't done the test yourself, are you not putting faith into those documents that you have read, that the people who put forth those arguments actually did the test that you're relying upon? Are you not placing your faith in saying, I believe that they're telling the honest truth from the test that they did? Now, you didn't do the tests.
I am actually doing those tests.
You've done all the tests, some of the arguments that you're putting forward.
Mm-hmm.
Do you not have to trust
trust is not faith, and confidence is not faith.
Do you not
That's
have
a
to put your faith? Don't right. do you not I have to put your faith
I,
in? Those the faith. Integrity of the people that are putting forth those arguments. You have to put faith
I
in
don't
that.
Have faith because faith would be a belief that is not based on evidence.
Not putting
I
faith
do my,
in
I do my
that
own
they're
research.
Putting forth honest evidence.
I do,
they're
I
not,
do
my, not making it up.
I
you
do
not making
I
it up.
I do my own research to confirm
on,
these things.
On everything that you have argued tonight, there's all of it. You've done tests on all of it. You're not putting any faith in...
So far, yes. That would be an accurate statement.
Everything that you've stated this evening, you have tested yourself.
So far, yes.
That's insane.
Well, it's not really. If you look at the video that I just did where I interviewed
you've tested
D.M. Murdoch.
Everything that you said, you've tested.
Yes. And I can prove
that's
it.
That's insane.
You've tested the integrity of the people who reported the evidence.
Yes, and I can demonstrate that.
How do you test their integrity? Did you call them up?
I'm trying to explain that to you right now. I was trying to explain that to you. I was trying to answer the question when you interrupted it to ask the question. In a recent interview that I had with D.M. Murdoch, who's apparently the foremost expert on Moses mythicism, I was confirming her research, and I had already done my own independent research years prior. And I'm comparing my notes to hers. Now, a lot of hers, I read at least half of her book so far. There was a lot of that I can confirm from my own independent studies. So I know where she's getting this information from. And I was able to provide for her information she didn't already have that I had already pulled up on my own. So, yeah, I do my own research on this. I'm also, when I give the definition of faith, again, I've stated it again and again. Confidence is not faith. I have confidence because I have evidence, and because it has consistently borne out, and because in every discussion, the religious side always collapses. There's never anything that they can actually show to be correct. I normally concentrate on arguing with creationists, and so it's really easy there to show that there's absolutely nothing that they can say that is actually right, but that I can show several things that are actually factual about evolution. So I know what the probabilities are. I have the evidence to back me up, and I do my own research on that.
You know, I've brought this up 100 times, well, not 100 times, I'm exaggerating, that you don't test every single thing. I've been talking about you with you for about an hour. You don't test everything. And Bible Thumping Wingnut is getting out there, and he's saying it the same thing. You have faith in certain things. You're ridiculously self-refuting.
I'm not self-refuting anything. He did say that everything, that he asked me to clarify if everything I've said up to this point had been verified by myself. And yes, everything that I had stated up to this point, I have actually verified myself. So that is
Have verified the integrity, the methodology, and everything of all the people involved in all this research.
Have I done all of the research on all of the people? No. That means I haven't done it.
You assume that they're going to be honest.
I don't have to, because I can verify on my own. My own independent research aligns. And simultaneously, because I can show where the scientific aspect, where the historians and the scientists and everything, they all have an account that lines up with my own research, and everything that I studied all lines up. And then we have the apologists with nonsense that is unprecedented and unparalleled and impossible. But which is asserted without any evidence.
Apologist. What nonsense?
Okay. You just said that God is bigger than big and stronger than strong.
I didn't say that.
Exceeds every dimension we can exaggerate, but you don't have the evidence to back that up.
You did say that.
He was omniscient and that he was omnipotent. Yes, he did. Yes, you did.
When we talk about the issue of evidence, I asked you, what kind of evidence would you expect from a transcendent being?
And since you won't investigate what transcendent means, and we'll just pretend that I don't know.
I did. I defined you. This is the fourth or fifth time I'm telling you what transcendence is. It is when God is not dependent upon the physical universe. He's not dependent upon space and time for his existence. He transcends them. He's not limited and restricted to them. That's about the fourth or the fifth time I'm telling you what it is, and you keep telling me I don't tell you what it is.
So I'm still correct then that you said he's bigger than big and stronger than strong and exceeds every dimension one can exaggerate.
I never said any of that.
But you did just exactly say all of that just now.
I just said he's bigger than big and stronger than strong.
Smarter than smart, omniscient, exceeds every dimension. He transcends.
He's bigger than big is a nonsensical. Statement.
To pretend I use the words that you used because they made the same
pretend?
Thing.
Pretend.
Yeah, because that's what it is. Bigger than big, stronger than strong. He exceeds. He's bigger than the universe and is in unlimited power. They mean exactly the same thing.
I never said he was unlimited power.
You did say he was omnipotent, right?
Omnipotent. You don't understand Christian theology. You do not understand what you criticize.
Do I understand the word omnipotent?
Define it for me.
All-powerful. Unlimited power, right?
Nope. Does that mean unlimited power?
Okay. Well, even though...
Wonder what it means?
Yeah, please. Even though other definitions you've gotten so far have been demonstrably wrong,
Am I qualified enough, do you think, to define Christian theology?
Oh yeah, you can define Christian theology.
Do you think I'm good enough to explain it, knowledgeable enough, degreed enough to explain Christian theology since I've been teaching it since 1980?
Well, I gotta contest one little thing about that.
You didn't answer the question.
No, I am answering the question. This is my answer that you're interrupting to ask the question again.
Wow.
Since there is no aspect of either Christian theology or any other religion that anyone can actually show to be correct, then it doesn't really make any difference what anyone's degrees are. Because you can have people with PhD degrees who disagree with each other, and there's no way to verify which one is correct.
So there's no aspect of any of my religious faith that can be demonstrated as being true?
Oh, if it were real, it could be, yes.
Okay, so
then it would be perfect.
So let me test that. I am a Christian. You said there's nothing in my faith that can be shown to be true. Well,
right.
I have faith that Jesus lived. My faith is that Jesus did live. That is an aspect of my faith. It is real, and it is true that I believe that. So I've now shown you, I've now shown you that that aspect, I've now shown you that that aspect.
Right, you can show me that you believe the thing that is not supported by evidence.
You said no aspect. You said none.
There's nothing that your religion or any other religion can show that is true about the things they believe. Now, yes, you can tell me that you believe it, but you can't show me that there was a Jesus. You can't show me that,
no,
that,
I can't.
That it was a God.
I can't. I can't take you a time machine and take it back there and say, "Here he is now. Touch his cloak." I can't do
right.
that.
Right. If we could, then we'd have. I wish that we had a time machine because it would solve this so easily. Because then you'd be wandering around trying to find this Jesus character, and I don't know if you would ever give up when you couldn't find him. But so you believe that there's this, but you don't have any indication that there is a Jesus. There's nothing
yes,
you
I
can tell me.
Yes, I do
okay,
have an indication.
What is your evidence? How can you show me that anything that Christians...
You said I don't have any indication.
Mm-hmm.
I
right.
do have so, two.
Okay, what is it?
What are they? I have two.
Okay.
One is, and I do not offer this as proof to you, but you said any indication.
All right, well, I did ask for you to show some aspect of Christian theology that is actually
I
true.
Did. I you did. Christian theology... asserts that people have faith in Christ. I have faith in Christ. That's an aspect of Christian theology that's just shown to be true.
You can't actually show that there's... Okay, yeah, it's true that you believe things that you can't show to be true. That much of given. I grant you. You can show that Christians and Hindus and Jains and Sikhs all believe things that they can't show to be true. But my statement was that you can't show that these things are actually true.
I
now,
cannot take you...
I can I, show things that are actually true.
I cannot take you back into a time machine and say, look, there's Jesus.
Right, and you can't demonstrate the truth of anything else in Christian theology.
What do you mean?
All you can show me is that you...
Anything else? Anything else, right?
There's no aspect of Christian theology or any other religious theology of their belief system that they can actually show is really true. It's
and
all...
So, let me ask you. So it has to be shown to you, right?
Well, it doesn't have to be to me in particular. If you could give some demonstration that would appeal to the experts, when my knowledge fails me, I could rely on the experts instead, perhaps.
So, in other words, some demonstration that appeals to the experts. Which experts?
A consensus. Once again, when I said that Einstein's relativity was proven, this was
which
a
experts?
Scientific. It. A consensus. A consensus.
Which experts?
A consensus.
I didn't ask what consensus. I said, you said, I have something to demonstrate that appeals to the experts.
A consensus of the experts.
What experts? In what?
A consensus. Do you know what that means?
Yes, yeah, a majority view that's held by a group of people, the general consensus. But I'm asking you what experts. Do you know what experts means?
Yes, of course I know what experts.
Then tell me what experts.
So if you can take out the ones who are going to reject all reason.
The fact that you ignore so many of my questions when you're cornered demonstrates your position is incredibly weak.
I'm not ignoring any of your questions.
Yes, you are. What experts?
I'm answering this one,
what
for
experts?
Example. I'm answering that question. Why are you ignoring my answers to tell me that I'm ignoring the questions that I'm trying to answer, but I can't answer? You keep interrupting the answer to tell me that
what
I'm ignoring
experts?
The question. I'm answering that question if I could get to the answer.
Go ahead.
If you could,
what experts?
As I said, a consensus would mean that you've eliminated whatever minor percentage of wouldn't accept anything, and then you have an overwhelming majority who accept this data. So it doesn't matter who they are, as long as it's an overwhelming majority.
Oh, okay, so the Christian experts, now that's what I'm going to cite because it doesn't matter who they are. So I guess we prove Christianity is true because the overwhelming consensus of the theological experts demonstrates it's true.
But you don't have a consensus. You're only saying that among Christians, you can get Christians to agree that they believe in Jesus, but you can't get a consensus.
What experts?
Well, it would have to be experts from other belief systems or none. It would have to be all-inclusive. It would have
experts from a belief system or not a belief system.
That would mean that you can't just say that it would be just Christians, because then we can also prove that Islam is
the correct. You said it didn't matter what experts.
Right, as long as it's a consensus. But you're not talking about a consensus. You're talking.
You said it doesn't matter what experts. So I said, okay, then I'll pick the ones that I like, and it does, because it doesn't matter to you. But it does.
Right, that's correct. It doesn't
you
matter
contradict yourself.
Who the experts are, as long as you have a consensus. But since you don't, since you only have Christians and not Sikhs, Muslims, Hindus, atheists, and all the rest, then you don't have a consensus.
You said it doesn't matter what kind of experts. I just go with what you said. So which experts? Give me a couple names, a couple fields.
Again, I can't give you a couple of names if you're going to talk about overwhelming majority.
Anthropology, philosophy, theology. Medicine?
An overwhelming majority. And that would mean you can't just have Christians say, yeah, we believe there's...
Have you ever heard of a fallacy called argumentum ad populum?
Again, if we're talking about a consensus on scientific examination, then this is going to mean that there's going to be some people who don't accept reason at all, who are not going to be good scientists, or for whatever reason abstain from the norm. But everyone else would be convinced. So we can get a consensus where we have an overwhelming majority who all say that, yes, this was compelling evidence for me. This conclusively proves the situation, because there's only 44 guys out of 44 million that don't accept this.
Okay.
So that would be a consensus. When everyone agrees. So you said that you proved that God exists, and yet the entire world is still questioning, is there a God?
Had you
proved that God exists,
yes,
then this wouldn't be a matter of faith anymore.
I can prove it.
Okay.
You want to try?
Okay.
I've only done this 1,000 times, and every attempt has failed, but go ahead.
Let me try this, okay, Bible thumping? All right, let me try this with him. Let's see how far we go.
Let me clarify something. If he's going to prove that God exists, Nobel Prize to this guy, because he's going to render faith as no longer a necessity for religion. He might even define what it means to be a Christian, so that everybody knows it's the Christian God and not just any God. So we no longer have Hindus or Muslims. Everyone will say, hey, this guy gets the Nobel Prize because he proved God exists, and he proved which one it was. I, however, suspect that you're going to play the word game. You're going to try to argue that we can't really know if we're real, or we can't really know if we're sane, that somehow reality isn't real, and that science is just as much faith as religion is, and all of these kinds of word games, and then you ultimately won't prove anything. And that a month from now, this will still be a matter of faith for all religious people around the world.
I didn't know you believed in mind reading and prediction.
I don't.
So you have faith, that's what I'm going to say.
I obviously don't have faith in anything, since that is the most dishonest position it's possible to have, and you are demonstrating that by repeating it so often.
Okay. You ready?
Of course.
Okay, so if you only have two options to account for something and one is negated, the other one's validated, is that not logically true?
No.
So you don't affirm a disjunctive syllogism?
No, if you're only aware of two options, you may not have considered...
I didn't say only aware, I said if there are only two.
Then you may not be aware of a third.
That's called the Chilahanti fallacy. Look, God, not God.
At all.
We have two. We have two options. God, mm-hmm. not God. Is there a third option?
No. In that case, no. There's not. There's either.
Okay.
There's
so we have two options to work
there's
from.
There's either going to be a universe that exists the way it evidently is, or there's going to be the one you suggest, which is exactly the same, but with the superfluous element added to it.
Okay. So we have God, or we don't have God. There's no third option, correct?
I grant that. Yeah.
Okay, so we only have two possible explanatory views, right?
Except one is not explanatory.
We only have two explanatory views, right? God, not God.
God is not an explanatory view.
I'm sorry?
God is not an explanatory view.
Okay, we only have two positions and worldviews from which we can draw conclusions and make observations and then hypothesize explanatory things. So either one...
We have one that works, and then we have the God one. We can't make the hypotheses and such from the God thing.
So,
that's really? Not
okay. So we have the laws of logic, which undergird rational thought. So they're rational by nature, they're thought by nature, because their laws are abstractions. So how do you, as an atheist, account for their universality, their transcendent existence, which is not dependent upon the universe, not dependent upon human mind? How do you account for their existence from your atheistic perspective?
Would you agree that in a universe that is completely dead, that two rocks are still, you know, if you, two rocks plus two rocks, still going to be four rocks?
What you're doing is you are asserting a logical value right now about another condition. You're assuming the laws of logic. I'm asking you to account for them from your atheistic perspective.
So if there is a universe in which there is no God, then 2 plus 2 still equals 2.
If there is no God, there is no universe. God's a necessary precondition. I'm trying to ask you to do something, and you, what you do is you dodge it. You can't.
I didn't dodge anything. You're dodging because we have.
You're dodging. How do you explain it from an atheistic universe?
We either have the universe that works according to the processes as our evident, or we have the exact same universe which you depict, which also has the superfluous element added to it. Now, in the one that doesn't have.
Where the laws of logic come from?
Where do the laws of logic come to? They are something like with the laws, like with the scientific laws. They are things that we can derive. They are actual fact, and then we can determine them.
So you presuppose the laws of logic in order to observe things and make conclusions.
I don't presuppose anything. None of the laws are.
But you tested the laws of logic.
I could test laws of logic, but that's not.
How would
the
you
issue.
Test the laws of logic?
I don't know. Why are you changing the subject?
You said you could. I'm asking you. How would you test them?
I asked you a question, which you have then touched to dodge, while telling me that I'm dodging the question that you're
you
dodging.
You are the master dodger.
I'm not dodging
I'm
anything.
I'm asking you. I asked you a specific question.
I asked you a specific question, which you dodged, in a universe in which there is no God. It's 2 plus 2.
I can't affirm that position.
Why not?
Because I don't believe it's possible.
Why not?
Because I don't believe it's possible. It's another topic. And part of the answer lies in this question, in this thing.
Do we agree that we have two different positions here? We either have the universe as it is, in which there is no God, or we have the universe that you suggest, in which there is this ghostly figure added to it. Right. This is the position.
You are just begging the question left and right, and you're condescending
and asking God.
You assume. You assume your naturalism.
You're dodging.
Brother, look, you know what?
You make
so many assumptions. You assume there is no God.
I'm not assuming anything.
Yes,
why do you
are.
Keep asserting these things on me that aren't
because
true?
That's what you do.
I ask the question. You dodge the questions. You accuse
I don't dodging anything. You assume the question.
You're in fact doing.
You beg the question.
I'm not
you assume there is no God.
I said, do you agree? That we have these two positions. I'm arguing for a universe in which there is no God and everything works according to the principles and properties and processes that we can see evident. Or we have your perspective in which there is this God added to it. Now, in either universe, 2 plus 2 equals 4, right?
How do you know?
I'm asking you a question. I'm asking you how you know.
No, because the universe can't exist without God. And God is a necessary precondition for the universe.
You're making an assumption. You're making an assumption without any evidence at all and without any justification at all.
I don't have any evidence.
What is your evidence that you can't
have anything? I'm trying to show it to you, but you keep dodging.
Okay. I never dodge anything. So since you've got nothing, and I'm going to ask you again, what is your evidence? What is your evidence? I'm waiting for it.
I'm trying to show you.
Great.
Evidence for God to show. Okay? So you know.
Try it out here.
Okay, let's try it again. This shouldn't be that difficult.
Yeah, it shouldn't be, but you're obstinate. Now, give me the evidence that I keep having to ask for and which you keep failing to produce.
Okay, I'm trying to show you, but you do not want to have anything shown to you contrary to what you assume by faith.
Wrong. That's your position because I don't have faith. That's a false
statement.
Yes,
you do. You're a faithful man.
I do not have faith. Faith is a belief that is not dependent on evidence. I have evidence for what I believe. Part of the evidence
is
that all of the apologists, I've ever talked to have failed to provide anything. It has nothing to do with what I want to
Because you don't shut up long enough or let them talk.
Apologetics because it is about what you
You don't let them talk long enough.
I'm tired of being falsely accused.
Stop
Look
telling
who's
me
talking.
I don't have
Look
faith.
Who's talking, you and your false accusations about me and about God and all these things that you assume.
You have already demonstrated. You keep telling me I have faith. I don't have faith.
Yes, you do.
You have faith. Okay, fine.
You have faith that you're the same person you were a week ago. You have faith in the validity of the laws of logic. You have faith in the
I have confidence. I don't have faith. They're not the same thing.
Yes,
and
do.
I told you that 60 times.
You have faith. They're not the same thing.
I have a difficulty understanding. How many more times do I have to tell you this?
About 50. Maybe it'll get to your head that you're being inconsistent.
I'm being certainly consistent.
You are not consistent.
This an hour and a half.
You're one of the most inconsistent atheists I've ever met.
All we've done is argue in circles. You've made false allegations against me.
Can we go now? Can I try the argument without you trying to interrupt every three syllables?
Can you say something that isn't wrong for three syllables?
Yes, I can. I am a man.
Good. Let's see it. What's your evidence?
Now, we only have two explanatory views, God and not God. The laws, what?
No, we don't. As I said before, God is not an explanatory
view. What's the third view, then?
We don't. God is not an explanatory view.
What?
God is not an explanatory view.
God is not something that I can use to explain anything?
Right.
Why not?
Because it isn't an explanation. Magic doesn't explain anything.
Who says God is magic?
The dictionary, the Bible.
The dictionary says God is magic?
Again, what's the thing? I'll give you this again. Magic and miracle together, same definition, invocation of supernatural powers or entities to control or forecast natural events, which are, secondarily, inexplicable by science because they defy the laws of physics. Now, that's what magic slash miracle is. This
no,
is not
it's the art of presenting illusions as entertainment.
No, no. Look
it's not.
It
that's, I'm reading it off of dictionary.reference.com. That's not it?
That's right. If you look up all these definitions, you're going to find that there's a religious context, and then there's an illusion context. But you have to find the context that is consistent with the topic we're talking about, which is religion. And you, as you compare
so
all these...
Go, magic. God is magic in religion.
Go to One Look Encyclopedia, for example. I've done the research on this. I know what faith is. I can cite all the different sources. So, stop imposing...
Cite me two right now.
What?
Cite me two sources on faith right now that give what your definition is.
Well, the one that we just discussed a moment ago where Jesus says, you know, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed, and we walk on faith, not
by
sight.
So you quote Jesus as your authority?
Things that are not... Well, yeah, I have to go to your sources if I'm going to use it the way you do. Right?
And you okay, so you quote Jesus. That's good. I'm glad you go to Jesus for your authority. That's good.
You're going
to
cite the storybook as your source, so I should go to the storybook to cite
I'm
the
so
same.
Glad you like Jesus.
Is that
the problem
not
with you, the problem with you, what has to happen with you is a real formal debate where you're not allowed to interrupt, where you have to answer the questions in front of full view of a public that you can't answer. And for you to say that God is not an explanation is simply a begging the question assumption on your part.
It's not begging the question. It's not an explanation. God did it, does not explain how God did it. Saying, well, God did it with his miracles. If you don't want to say magic, say miracles. It's the same thing. Doesn't make any difference. But it still isn't an explanation. We have processes. We have mechanisms by which we can explain things. Magic is not an explanation. So God is not an explanation.
I don't believe in magic.
What?
I don't believe in magic. Atheists always bring up magic.
Because it's the same thing as miracle. They have the same
magic
definition.
Is the same thing as a miracle?
Yes.
Really? Then why are they different words and different things in the Bible? Magic does not... Brother.
Okay, whatever you want to call what you and I both know as magic, call it something else. I don't care.
Okay.
But it still isn't an explanatory view.
You know what? I'm going to tell you something, man. You are the most idiotic person I've ever had to deal with. You couldn't argue your way out of a wet paper bag.
Well, you haven't been able to...
So many logical fallacies. And you have so much faith in your ability to be rational. You are so faithful. You can't even prove that you're rational. You just assume it. You are a big man of
faith.
You're a faithful person.
Exactly what you would do in this situation, that you will try for 45 minutes to argue for something that you can't defend, and then when you fail at defending it, then you would become insolatory. This is a common in all the comment sections.
You're just a faithful man. You have faith in your own ability.
I don't have faith. I have confidence, but I don't have faith.
Oh, no, you're faithful, because your faith, trust me, your faith is way, way, way beyond the evidence.
Right. Bible thumping wingnut, are you there?
Well, what's wrong, RN? I'm calling you out. You see, you are so illogical. What you do is you contradict yourself so many times.
You're interrupting. Tell me that I'm interrupting, and we're done here.
You talk over me all the time.
Okay. Yeah, because you start every phrase with a false accusation, trying desperately to pin faith on me when I will not have
that. You're a man of faith.
I will not bear faith. Faith
yes,
is
you
the
do it all the time.
There is, and you are demonstrating that.
You're a man of faith.
And I will not wear that label.
Okay.
You have faith in science.
I do not have faith. I have confidence. Faith is a belief, once again, for the thousandth time
then
today.
Then you have faith in your confidence.
It's not based on evidence. I base my beliefs on evidence. Since all you can do is falsely accuse me, and that's all you can do, we are done here. Bible thumping wingnut. I am logging off of this call. I want to thank you, and good night.
Good night.
I do want to publicly thank him for coming on. He didn't have to do that. I wanted to have him on because he's very well known. Some may say that he's the face of atheism on the internet. So
if he's the face of atheism, seriously, then atheism is in really bad shape.
Well, I do believe a lot of people do look up to him as kind of a spokesperson for the position. I'm going to add the other guys to the conversation. I'm going to add, we've got Matt Yester. I think I've already added him.
Yeah, I'm on.
Len Pettis is, I believe, here. And I wanted to ask him, guys, of course, none of us want to misrepresent his position here. We're going to do our best to you know, reminisce about what just happened. But did he say that if a majority of people, of experts, agree that God existed,
yep, he did.
Then God exists, right?
Well, see, his mistake, he made so many mistakes.
But let me just look at this one, though.
This one.
He said that if a majority consensus of experts, which he wouldn't identify experts, if a majority of experts agreed that God exists, then God exists. Are there not more people who believe that God exists in the world than not?
Very good point. Well, but he would say they're not experts because they have faith. So he would, by definition, disqualify anybody who believes as not qualified to be an expert. This is why I was asking him repeatedly, what expert? Because he would not answer that question.
Yeah, he can't identify what the experts are.
No, he can't. You see, this guy, and I'm serious, I was trying to tweak him a little bit, but this guy is the most illogical, irrational atheist I think I've ever come across. And I'm not just saying that to be mean. Seriously, I can't recall that many mistakes in thinking and logic in like a 5-minute period that this guy produced. It was amazing.
Quick enough because you couldn't get a word in edgewise, really.
Yeah. I mean, begging the question, category mistake, equivocation, conflation, fallacy of division. He was assuming the uniformity of nature based on the inductive principle, which he couldn't validate as being true. He couldn't establish his own continuity, and this is one of the ways to prove it's a philosophical argument, the continuity issue. No one can prove that they're the same person they were a week ago. We assume that we are. What's the evidence? Well, the evidence itself had to be assumed as being valid, a continuity of what you assume as being your thought. It's a major philosophical discussion, and you can't prove anything, and there's no scientific way to demonstrate the actuality.
Yes, there is. There's a driver's license and a birth certificate,
yes.
Matt. Come on now.
Yeah, that's right. And so when he brought up the birth certificate thing, and I said, oh, so because it says so on a document, that makes it so. I mean, this is ridiculous argumentation from him. And I'm not kidding. It was ridiculously bad to see him make so many blatant errors left and right. I'm not kidding. It was amazing. It really was bad. This is the face of atheism. You know, there are better atheists out there. And I'm you know, seriously, he just made so many mistakes left and right and built upon them. He can't be the best face of atheism.
You know, he kept saying that he has no faith. Everything he believes, or not believes, but
he's testing.
He has evidence. Yeah. Evidence. And he made so many assertions without evidence. His assertion that there is no God, which of course then is you assume then that nothing exists outside of nature, anything, you know, basically naturalism. And where's the evidence for that? I mean, like you said, it's just constant question begging. I was embarrassed for him within the first 10 minutes of the conversation.
Well, when I define faith for him, you know, biblically, then, you know, I mean, biblically defining faith, well, you know, out of what Jesus himself said, then he denies that part of it and then goes with what the next thing that Jesus said, blessed are those who haven't seen and believe. He goes, that's what the real faith is. And what justifies him getting rid of one and going with the other when Jesus apparently said both? I mean, I remember someone called it the taxi cab fallacy. You're driving along, you're inside the argument, you jump out of it, you argue, then you get back in. And so you go arbitrarily back and forth, not being consistent in the argumentation. He was not consistent in his argumentation.
Yeah, you gotta be consistent with your own standard, and if you violate your standard, then you're applying a double standard.
Yes, and he was definitely doing that. It's another issue. He didn't understand what transcendence was. And you know how many times did I define transcendence for him? What, 4 or 5 times, literally?
Yeah.
At least three.
I think it was 4, maybe 5. But at any rate, at least 3. And he kept saying, I hadn't told him what transcendence was. And then to actually say, well, if God's transcendent, could he transcend his transcendence? You know, it's just, I mean, I was actually not stumped, but stopped in my tracks by that question. Because it revealed to me how utterly ridiculous he was thinking. That I couldn't believe he said that. It's like, are you kidding me?
The Bible has a lot to say about this, though, doesn't it, Matt? I mean, about the mind of the unbeliever being veiled to the truth and being darkened in their understanding and professing to be wise, they become fools. I mean, let's just get right into the gospel, Matt. What hope is there for someone like Aaron?
There is no hope if he doesn't give up his idolatry of his own ability to think and his faithful expectation and scientific method, which is based upon certain assumptions that he denies are assumptions. He has to give up on all of these idols that he bows down before. And he's got to come to the truth of who Jesus is and the resurrection. But, of course, he denies Jesus' existence, and he absolutely denies Moses exists. There is no hope for this guy outside of Christ, of course. He's enamored with his own ability, what he thinks he can think, and he doesn't. He's enamored with the idea that he's been sought out at different conferences to be able to speak and give all these things, but he's not cross-examined in those scenarios, and people don't call him out on his numerous logical fallacies. This guy is, I believe, entranced and in love with his own position and ability that he thinks he can do in rational thought, and so I believe, this is my opinion, it's my observe, because I've rarely seen anybody that stubborn and that irrational that as he. That this is what his problem is. He needs to be humbled before God, and he won't be humbled because he doesn't want anything to do with God. He thinks he knows more than God, is smarter than God, which reminds me a whole bunch of stuff. God's smarter than smart, bigger than big. Wow. I mean, what do you do? Is he bigger than big?
I think part of the frustration is that he has learned how to use terminology on so many different levels, the terms that he uses are misrepresentation of the Christian faith.
Yes.
And that's one of the reasons why he's so popular, because he can say the most simple basic statement, and the non-believer is like, yeah. I mean, not only is he making a statement, but he's destroying.
Well, think about this. It reminds me, what you just said reminds me. He wants experts to be the ones who say what something really is or is not, right? He wanted experts. He wouldn't say which experts, but he wants experts. So we come to the issue of faith, which is a theological issue. I don't like to say I'm the expert, but I think I'm qualified enough and within the category of expert, hopefully, I hope that's not boasting, to be able to say this is what faith is biblically. And then he denies my expertise. So what he would do is he wants experts, but I don't qualify in the theological area that he's citing. And yet he will tell me and tell others what Christianity really is about and what faith really is in the Christian context. But he's not an expert. His inconsistencies are just profound and constant.
I don't think he's used to talking to somebody like you, and I think from my perspective, of course, I'm coming from the Christian side, but I think even people on the other side would say that perhaps he learned some things that he shouldn't use in an argument against somebody with your qualifications as a apologist, because they just fell flat on their face.
Well, I want to say two things, though. One, I will admit I was getting a little agitated with him. I sometimes do get agitated with someone who is so incredibly irrational so consistently. It's hard to argue with a wall that can't, in my opinion, think clearly. But also, I was trying to tweak him a little bit. I wanted to see how far he would go in his irrationality. Then he gave up and you know, he's done. So I just want to say that.
Well, we want to make it clear that we are no better than anybody. We are no more worthy of the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ than the worst person in the world. It's only through God's grace and mercy that he's granted to us, the faith and repentance that we possess. We're all dead in our sins. We all are in need of a Savior. We're all guilty of breaking God's laws and really deserve the just punishment that is due us, and that is eternal torment from God and for eternity. And by God's grace, he's granted us, he's brought us to life, he's taken out our heart of stone and granted us repentance, and we give him all the honor and glory. It's not anything in us, that has qualified us to become Christians. It's only through the power of Jesus Christ. And God calls all of us to repent. He calls all of us to admit that we're sinners, to admit that we're fallen short to the standard of perfection, and recognize that it's only through the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, that we could be reconciled, that the payment that's due us, all of mankind, was actually not going to be put on us, but by God's decree was poured out on Jesus Christ on the cross. The wrath that was due all believers was poured out on Jesus Christ on the cross on our behalf, and when that occurred, our sins were placed on Christ, and he was crucified and took those sins to the grave, and Christ's righteousness was transferred to the believers. And then now, even though I continue to struggle in sin, even though I'm still, you know, growing in sanctification and fall short, I am clothed in the righteousness of God, not because of anything that I've done or I'm worthy or because I chose, but because of the work of God. I now stand in perspective from God as if I lived a perfect life. And that's not me saying, hey, I don't have to pay the consequences of my sins. That's no scapegoat. That's a work of Christ that he decreed and he carried out for his sheep. And we follow Christ, and one of the things that we should do is preach the gospel, and those that God will grant mercy to and grace will respond. And so we call all men to repentance. We call all men to recognize that they're sinners and call upon the Lord. And all who do call and ask forgiveness will receive. And I would encourage everyone to do that. And anyone on this panel would be glad to receive communication for anybody who wants to know more about that. Aaron Raw, I'm sure you've heard this message before, but we would just, first of all, thanks for coming on, and please, please, turn from your sin, trust Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and be born again for the glory of God.
It should be stated that the reason we do these, the reason that we have these encounters is because of our genuine concern for the lost and our trust in the scripture insofar as where it says that his sheep will hear his voice and follow. You know, Jesus is a good shepherd and he came to lay his life down for the sheep. And, you know, all of our sincere prayers is that Aaron and anyone watching would be one of his sheep and turn to Christ by faith. And sometimes these conversations get pretty heated. And I hope that what's not lost on all this is the fact that we do this out of a deep sense of urgency for the soul of the individual that we're talking to and those who would hear, and also out of a love that we have for our Savior and wanting to bring glory to him in doing this, and the love that we have for the individuals. Like, if we didn't care, we just wouldn't say anything. You know, there was an atheist, Penn Jillette, who's, you know, half of the Penn and Teller team of magicians, and he's an atheist, and he stated in a YouTube video once how much he respects the Christian who will speak out and challenge unbelief, because it shows that they actually believe what they profess, and how hateful it would be for someone who claimed to believe the Bible and yet said nothing. Like, that would be the most hateful thing we could do as Christians. So even though these things get a little bit heated, it's out of a deep love and concern that we have for these individuals that we have these conversations.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's, what do I tell you?
Yeah.
Man.
Okay, I want to thank, again, Aaron Roth for coming on, and Matt, thank you for your time and your commitment to proclaim Christ and to stand in opposition to anyone at any time. And for those of you who want to know more about Matt Slick, you can go to carm.org. And I'm going to just close it. This is a good time to close it. I want to thank everybody who watched. We got as high as about 140 viewers at a time, so that was good. So thanks for watching, and stay tuned. We'll be doing more Hangouts like this. If you know somebody who would be interested in joining us, let us know. Go to BibleThumpingWeenit.com. You can communicate with us there. And that's it. Check out carm.org. Matt, thanks again for your time, and thank you to Aaron Roth for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.